spoke with this fellow I mentioned to you, the fellow that met Garth Kennedy on the street in Hollywood, and had a great conversation with him this morning. He's a fellow who is having some very big struggles leaving the institutional church, and having found the 1611, he's pretty much out there all on his own, and he needed somebody to talk to, and that was me. So he talked to me for quite a while. I think I talked with him for about an hour. There may be something there. We may want to consider interviewing him at some point, because people need to hear that they're not the only ones struggling with this situation, because it is a big change for people to, first of all, realize the Bible they're reading is not a pure testimony, whatever that Bible is. And the second thing is, once they realize that, and they come to the shocking realization that their whole church community is deceived, and then they try and help them, they get ostracized, and then they feel, my goodness, what have I done? I'm all out here by myself. So then they start looking around for another church, and they find they're all the same. And then finally they give up, and they become a little bit cynical. Then maybe they find the 1611.
You know, as you were speaking, Reg, I thought a great future project for us would be to get about, I'm just going to say maybe 8 to 10 people that are true 1611 believers, and get a compilation of maybe 5 minutes of testimony from each one of these 8 people that they can just briefly, maybe you can edit a 45-minute video where we just give different testimonies from various people that we've interviewed that believe in the 1611, but share their experiences, both positive in terms of their conviction by the Holy Spirit and negative, they're being isolated or persecuted by so-called believers or churches. That would be very interesting.
I'd like to do that.
I know a number of people which would be outstanding witnesses, whether it's a highly respected medical doctor or somebody that is a fairly well-educated former Catholic who's a college professor, or I have another friend who's a 1611 believer that is he happens to sell insurance for a living, but he was raised Lutheran and was a history major, got his degree in history from college, and then found out after he got born again or on the 1611 that nearly everything he was taught was false, but he would be another good interview. And of course, I've got my brother who is a 1611 believer and has put that on his business website, and I'm sure you're starting to meet more and more people. I think we could come up with a good 8 people that could give pretty good testimony there.
I think it's a good idea. If you want to put some thought into that and think about how we can go about that, then yeah. I'm all for it. I'll cooperate in whatever way, shape, or form to get it done.
It'd be good just to collect those testimonies, because I think at some point in the future, it would be nice to have a compilation that people can hear from a number of different testimonies that, look, they all have something in common, that they don't have a church to go to, but they have strong discernment over mm-hmm. things.
And you know, everybody I've talked to that has come to this place has had serious struggles on a personal level, and it seems like the devil has been doing everything to keep them distracted from getting to the truth. And then they've come to the realization, and their discernment has gone way up, and now they have all these other struggles on the side. My goodness, the devil doesn't want you to get to the 1611. He doesn't want you to have the true testimony. I have to be thankful, because my wife is 100% tuned in, and she doesn't need me telling her how things are. She doesn't need me teaching her. I'll ask her about certain things, and I've never told her what these things mean or what she's supposed to think. And she'll read the scripture in the 1611, and she'll read it in the KJV, and she'll say, oh, well, the KJV is wrong because of this, that, and the other, and here's why the 1611 is correct. And I never told her those things. So it's really quite remarkable.
That's a great testimony in and of itself. So my wife is very similar in that she's been very supportive of me. She was raised a Christian, and God convicted her. She was born again off the KJV, and then her pastor gave her a Revised Standard Version Bible, and she just went into a slumber and never really had any conviction to read it or go to church for like 25 years. I got saved and everything changed. She read the Bible, the real Bible, again, cover to cover, in parallel with a lot of these modern Bibles, and she recorded by the power and conviction of the Holy Spirit maybe 100 different departures that she was, as she read, she was independently prompted to write them down by the Holy Spirit, and I compiled them on an Excel spreadsheet, and she will testify that that's what the Lord taught her as far as the departures from modern Bibles to the KJV truth. And then she got on the 1611 shortly after I did, and she's been very supportive. She doesn't need to listen to our testimonies because she lives it 24/7. She's heard everything from me.
Yeah, I suppose vicariously my wife gets most of it in some way, shape, or form. But yeah. I don't go into a whole lot of detail because I can go on and on and on and keep stripping away the layers and going through all the reasons why something is a certain way. And eventually my wife just goes, okay, I don't want to hear anymore. I got stuff to do. Okay, fair enough. So I think that's a wonderful idea. And the other thing, of course, that I should address is we have been promising people that we would deal with the Septuagint. And we were going to do that today, and I was all for it until John sent me a PDF, a book by a fellow by the name of Dr. Williams. And Dr. Williams appeared to be on our side in the sense of not regarding the Septuagint as authoritative. But as I read through it, I realized there are many problems created by the people who are against the Septuagint, and there are many problems created by the people who are for the Septuagint, and it's very hard to sort through the truth. It seems like the scholars from both sides of the argument are more interested in winning debates than they are the truth. And so you and I talked about that last night and both agreed that we need to study the Septuagint and all the surrounding issues a lot more before we speak with as much authority as we can regarding this matter on our Lamp in the Dark channel. So I'm just saying this, John, because I think we need to keep people updated. If they've been looking forward to us discussing the Septuagint, they need to know that we're working on it and we're communicating with each other on it. And we want to be able to cut through all the nonsense that's out there. And it's coming from both sides of the argument. And that's the problem. So we will get to it. But in the meantime, John sent me a terrific PDF. It's called The Messiah, and it's 22 pages. I don't know that we'll get through the whole thing because there may be a lot of things that we need to talk about as we go through these verses because it's primarily driven by verses in the Old Testament and the New Testament, and that can take a lot of discussion sometimes. But you started out with John chapter 4, verse 25 and 26. And I'll just read those verses to get us started and then let you comment on that. And also, just to keep in mind, John, if you think of it, and I think of it when we get, I think it's the third frame where you bring in Bible verses that reference Bethlehem. And I studied that this morning in reference to Ruth chapter 3, verse 15, which you discussed and I discussed at length last interview, and the pronoun, he went to the city or she went to the city, which one is correct? And I realized that it is so important to the messianic prophecy and to the idea that Boaz is a type of the Messiah. Anyway, when we get to those verses, if we remember, I'll try and interject some of that information. It's not something you and I have talked about in the past, but there is a strong connection. He must go to the city because that's part of him being the kinsman redeemer. John chapter 4, verse 25. The woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Tell us about this verse, John, and tell us why you started with this.
I started with this because, truth be told, I was on YouTube or on the internet, and studying some of the popular websites and televangelists, and I came upon a video from John Hagee where he's looking into the camera and telling everybody that Jesus never claimed to be the Messiah. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. Really? And without getting off on too much of a tangent, John Hagee uses the Roman Catholic Bibles. He pays himself $1 million a year, and he's a good showman, but really, I don't think he knows much of anything about when it comes to real spiritual discernment. I said, hey, I remember reading that Jesus bears witness to himself being the Messiah. So I found it, John chapter 4, and that's what really started this particular sermon. And Jesus does say that he's the Messiah. So why do you have this prominent televangelist saying he didn't? It just goes to show the power of God to choose and send delusions to those that are full of themselves. And that's what started this whole thing about the Messiah prophecies. And then I think what we also wanted to talk about is there's a number of prophecies that foreshadow coming of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. And there's also a parallel story, parallel prophecies with a false Messiah coming. I think we want to get to both of those today in our discussion.
You know, you would think that John Hagee's church would clear out. Anybody who'd read their Bible would know that Jesus did claim to be the Messiah, that there's no question about that. And you'd think if he made a statement like that, and I know he did because I've heard that video where he says that Jesus did not claim to be the Messiah. And that is directly in contradiction to what the Bible actually teaches. You would think that that church would just clear out. There wouldn't be a single person sitting in those pews. Yet they lap it up and they go, oh, John Hagee, he must be right. He's a man of God. My goodness, people, what is wrong with the church?
Of course, whenever things slip from these well-known so-called Christians, they always have a masterful plan of backpedaling and re-clarifying what they actually meant. But that damage control only happened after there were countless people that came out, posted comments against him on that video. I can't remember if I saw it on YouTube. There's several places that you can find it on the internet. He's trying to do damage control, and unfortunately, in my opinion, it's to spare himself not only his reputation, but his financial empire that he's built over the decades as well. And Jesus Christ says, buy the truth, sell it not. He says to give freely, can't charge people for the wisdom of the Holy Spirit. And if God gives you a gift of discernment, you're not going to charge for it because it's nothing that you've earned. It's what God has given you without repentance. So I guess that's how I feel about it.
Yes, well, I think people like John Hagee are God's judgment on apostate Christians. He's basically said to these people, if you want lies, I'll give you your guy. If you want truth, clear out. But he gives you what you want, essentially. If you ask for it, he'll give it to you. And Lord, help you what you ask for. And these people have asked to be lied to. They want to hear what John Hagee and people like that have to say, and they're not interested in what the Spirit is saying to the churches. So
exactly.
But anyway, that is a good reason to be talking about this. Did you preach this as a sermon on Sunday or at previous times?
I did. I preached it as a sermon on Sunday this past week. But it's really going to evolve into a sermon series where I covered a lot of ground in my sermon, the entire 22 pages. And then I'm going to go back and do a deeper lesson on the prophecies because I only spent a couple hours putting this together. I'm sure for every prophecy that I was able to find, New Testament fulfilling Old Testament prophecy, if I were to spend more time, I could probably come up with hundreds that God put together, if not more. I think as you mature in your Christian faith, you come to the realization that the entire Old Testament foreshadows Jesus Christ. God reveals more and more over time. So that's at least been my experience.
Well, the Old Testament, what is a testament of? We have the Old Testament and the New Testament. They're both testaments of Jesus Christ. They testify in different ways, but they're both testaments of our Lord and Savior. And as soon as we start thinking they're otherwise, there's a lot of confusion that comes into the churches. And it's often taught by the pastors, well, it's a different testimony and they were under a different form of salvation. You'll particularly hear that from the dispensationalists, and we need not go down that road too far. But No, it's the same testimony. It's the same God. Both testaments are the same. One is foreshadowing, as you mentioned, and one is fulfilling. But it's the same Lord and Savior. No difference.
Yeah, exactly.
So we've got Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3. And then you've also put underneath that Matthew chapter 3, verse 1. So Isaiah 40, verse 3 says, "The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God." You've linked it up to Matthew chapter 3, verse 1 for a reason, probably, at 1, 2, and 3. "In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, The voice of one crying in the wilderness, Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight." So obviously, this is the connection to Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3. Give us your take on that, John.
Not having prepared or studied, but just by reading scripture and giving a discernment is, as I've read the Old Testament, the thing that stands out right now in my mind is Malachi. The closing of Malachi chapter 4, and I'm not looking at a Bible or anything at the moment, but it is a powerful announcement of John the Baptist on one level.
Mm-hmm, yes.
I mean, and announcing the Messiah. And when it prophesies in the book of Isaiah, which for people listening, Esaias is Isaiah. It's spelled a little differently in Matthew, but it is referring to the prophet Isaiah, that the voice of one crying in the wilderness is a fulfillment of what it said in Isaiah, as well as Malachi, in a number of places in prophecy. And John came because he wanted to announce the coming of the Messiah to fulfill the Old Testament prophecies, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And it's also kind of a reminder that straight is the way, narrow is the gate that leads to life, and few be there that find it.
And it's interesting, too, you referenced Malachi chapter 4, and Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. And in chapter 4, it's the conclusion of the prophets. It says the end of the prophets, which means there are no more prophets. But the last prophecy given in Malachi is the coming of John the Baptist. And in a way, that opens up the New Testament. We know there's a New Testament because John is now testifying of Jesus Christ. And the conclusion of the Old Testament is made very clear. And this is important in the context of the Apocrypha inserted into the 1611 Authorized King James Bible, because the 47 translators made it very clear when they put the end of the prophets, the Apocrypha is inserted in there, and it's very obvious that this is not part of the prophets of the Old Testament, because it's the end of the prophets. And we need not get into the Apocrypha per se, but that statement in Malachi sets up the premise that whatever comes in between the old and the new is not part of the canon of Scripture, if we can use the term canon. And you and I have talked a little bit about the Apocrypha, and maybe that's something we'll revisit. The Apocrypha is there for a completely different reason. It is not there to teach you doctrine per se. Let's look at the next verses. So there's two testimonies, and Jesus said, "In the mouth of two or three witnesses is the truth established." And this is really what you're proving here. And as you mentioned, you can find these witnesses all over the place. There are dozens of them, if not hundreds of them. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14 reads, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." And then Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which being interpreted is God with us. And there's two really important things here. One is the virgin shall conceive. And in the modern Bibles, they don't like that idea. They like to take that word virgin out and replace that with young woman to destroy that whole prophecy. And maybe that's something you can comment on as well.
Obviously, this means a little bit more more to me than it might some people, because I was raised Catholic, and the Virgin Mary, Catholic faith, is a very important person because she's viewed as a co-redemptrix, a mediator also between God and man, along in parallel with Jesus Christ. As you mentioned, in the modern Bibles, which almost all of them are aligned with the Roman Catholic text and based on the Septuagint Catholic text, for example, it says in many of these modern versions that it is a young woman, not a virgin, that will bear a child. For example, in the New Living Version, it says a young woman. It doesn't say anything about a virgin. It says in the New Revised Standard Version, which is an official Catholic Bible, the young woman. Some of them say virgin, some of them say young woman. There's a mixed bag there, but what the problem is that it leaves people uncertain as to what's the real word here. Is it a young woman or is it a virgin? The Revised Standard Version, which is another Catholic Bible, says young woman. So by changing the words, they're killing the prophecies, because if it says young woman in Isaiah and it says virgin in the New Testament in Matthew, there's no connection there anymore. It's important that we know that Jesus was born of a virgin, and that virgin gave birth to him and then later had to make an atonement for her sins by sacrificing turtle doves because she was under the law of Moses.
Yes, she was unclean. It's very clear in the 1611 that that's why she was doing that. And also she does mention somewhere else, I believe earlier in the book of Matthew, she refers to Jesus as her Savior, as her Redeemer, obviously acknowledging her sin, being a sinful person. So it must be a virgin. And you've pointed this out numerous times, that the modern Bibles wreck prophecies, and particularly in reference to the NIV, that it has destroyed all the essential prophecies because you can no longer find the witnesses because they've changed so many words that you start looking around for the witness and it's gone. It's simply not there. But the 1611, the witnesses to every verse are so plentiful. It's unbelievable. You start studying it and you'll find witness after witness. And these are obvious witnesses. I'm not talking about the Holy Spirit illuminating you where you're now becoming full of spiritual discernment, which takes you up a whole other level, because again, there are many other references that require spiritual discernment. They're not literal. And again, they confirm the prophecies. So God is faithful to tell the truth and establish the truth in the mouths of 2, 3, 4, or hundreds of witnesses, whatever is required. But you must have the 1611 for that. Even the KJV, it's certainly better than all the modern translations. But you and I have showed in many places where essential prophecies are destroyed. And in the next frame, you've got Micah chapter 5, verse 2, and Matthew chapter 2, verse 5. I'm going to read those verses and then get you to comment on that. And then I'm going to reference Ruth chapter 3, verse 15, because this is one of those prophecies that has to be spiritually discerned, and it all fits together. Micah chapter 5, verse 2 reads, "But thou, Bethlehem, Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose going forth have been from old, from everlasting." And then Matthew chapter 2, verse 5, "And they said unto him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel." So John, you've correlated those two verses or those two excerpts. Could you comment on that a little bit, please?
The thing that I'm discerning right now is that Jesus Christ is called the Lion of the tribe of Judah, and he's the ruler, the Most High, and his people are called Israel. That's the Christian church. Israel is not the Jews in a literal sense anymore. They're Jews in a spiritual sense. That's what it says in the New Testament. Not a Jew outwardly, but a Jew inwardly. One that has been circumcised, not of the flesh necessarily, but of the heart. Mm-hmm. And maybe the flesh, but of the heart. That's what's important. So he's going to rule over his people, Israel, and he in Micah chapter 5 there, which ties into Matthew chapter 2.
Exactly. Now, I'm going to talk about Ruth chapter 3 verse 15 in a second, but one thing that is very interesting in Micah chapter 5 verse 2 is it says from everlasting. And the modern Bibles destroy this prophecy because they change that word to things like from ancient times, making Jesus no longer eternal God, but taking the Gnostic position that is found in the Alexandrinus manuscripts and the Vaticanus and the Sinaiticus and all the other junk that came out of Alexandria. And they don't like that word, so they change it. And now you can make an argument from Micah 5:2 in the corrupt Bibles. Well, it's not everlasting, it's from ancient times. Are you familiar with that change?
Yes, as you mentioned it, I am familiar with it. I happen to be looking at a long list of modern Bibles, and many of them, as you say, depart from everlasting, and they say something else, like, you know, from a long time ago, or ancient times, or ancient days. It seems initially, perhaps to the scholars or the scribes, to be similar enough, but it really destroys the perpetual, everlasting rule that Jesus Christ has.
Yeah, and his nature does not have a beginning. He is without beginning and without end, and the word everlasting expresses that. And as soon as we mess with that, we demote Jesus Christ to a Gnostic version of Jesus, just another good man. And you and I covered that quite thoroughly a couple of interviews ago, how the ascended masters have included Jesus in that bunch, and he's just one of many. And of course, you could prove that from Micah chapter 5, verse 2 in any modern Bible translation. So we must have the 1611, and I know some of the corrupt Bibles have the right word there, but they've got things messed up in other places. But what I wanted to say about this, John, is these verses correlate directly with Ruth chapter 3, verse 15, because Boaz must go to the city, because the word is kinsman redeemer I was looking for. He is the kinsman redeemer, and that is a type of Jesus Christ, in that he is standing in place of someone else and redeeming them in a particular way. But in order to do that, he must go into the city. And lo and behold, you know what the city is he must go into? Bethlehem.
Very interesting. Yeah, I'm sorry. Continue your thought, Reg.
He has to go into Bethlehem to do this. And when Ruth comes back from the threshing floor and she tells Naomi what went on. Now, Naomi set this whole thing up knowing what she was doing. I'm convinced of that. But she tells Naomi that Boaz told her to say nothing about it, and Boaz had given her some grain. And Boaz obviously didn't want anybody talking about this because it would be bad for his reputation, obviously. Even though nothing happened, people talk. And so Naomi says to Ruth, because of this, he must deal with this today before the sun goes down. He's got to nip this thing in the bud. That means he had to go right to the city to do this, because establishing the kinsman redeemer position had to be in the witness of the elders and others. And so he goes to the city. It must say he went to the city, and he did this expeditiously. And Naomi confirms that he must do that before somebody starts talking about this. Who knows who saw what? And so Boaz goes to the city just as the 1611 says. And he calls the elders together to sit at the gate, which is done inside the city. And then they wait for the man who is actually first in line to be kinsman redeemer doesn't want to do it. He does not want to risk his inheritance, he says. So he steps aside. And we get the feeling that all along Boaz wanted to be the kinsman redeemer, but there was somebody who was first in line. So this got dealt with in a very expeditious way at that time, and Boaz stepped up to the plate. But Boaz is a type of Jesus Christ. He's a kinsman redeemer. And Ruth is a type of the church, because Ruth was not an Israelite. She was not of that genetic heritage. She was a Gentile, a Moabitess, as the scripture says. Yet she was grafted into Israel. She was a believer. And so in Ruth, you have a perfect picture of the church. both Jew and Gentile, but neither Jew nor Gentile in a spiritual sense, so she's the perfect type of the church. Boaz is the type of Jesus Christ. He redeems the church, but he must come out of Bethlehem because that's where Jesus was born, and that's why he has to go into the city. And if we mess that up, we destroy all that richness of that prophecy. And this is not something that's overtly expressed. This is one of these things you and I have talked about that must be discerned spiritually.
I think that's an excellent synopsis that you just gave, Reg. That's something that you had spiritual discernment over, and you're one of just a handful of people that I know that has that discernment. My comment is, along with what you said, that Jesus Christ says he is the root and the offspring of David. So the devil wants to be like Jesus. He wants to be like the Most High. So on one hand, you've got Boaz, as you've said, is the root of David, literally.
Yes.
David is from his lineage. So God is telling the Christian church that when he's using Boaz, he's teaching us about Jesus, a Christ. Boaz obviously wasn't Jesus Christ, but he's giving us parables that foreshadow the Messiah, using Boaz and Ruth as examples of the church, as Ruth symbolizes, and as of redemption, the Redeemer. So you're right on there, but there is also, I want to bring to everyone's attention that in parallel, because the devil wants to be like the Most High, there is a counterfeit church and a counterfeit Redeemer all throughout the Bible as well. And the Bible, in a different chapter, the 1611, gives an account of a false Ruth, meaning the false church, and a false Boaz. And it's critical that we know that the false Boaz is already in the city because the false Ruth goes to meet him in the city. She's seeking him out. And what transpires in that other chapter in the Bible, which I really don't feel compelled to name right now, is critical to end time prophecy. So we know that he went to the city is the correct reading. Even the scholars acknowledge that. That's what the literal Hebrew said. But spiritually, he went to the city is critical because the bride or the false bride goes to meet the Messiah or the false Messiah in the city on a spiritual level. And I think what you said is perfect because it all ties into Micah chapter 5 and Matthew chapter 2 here.
Absolutely. But you raised something that I had meant to go into a little bit more detail about. You said that Boaz is of the root of David. And when you read chapter 4, verse 12, the name Pharis is raised. And Pharis and Tamar, because this relates back to Judah. Judah was the fourth son. And Judah is the one who, when they went to Egypt during the famine, he's the one who said, I will stand in the stead of Benjamin. Let the boy go. Do what you will to me. Whatever punishment you think you need to level on him, I will stand in his stead. And Judah steps up, despite all his flaws, he steps up as the surrogate, as the type of Christ who will stand in the stead. And Jesus said of this, no greater love hath a man than he would lay down his life for his friends. This is perhaps not a direct reference, but Judah, from which, of course, comes the tribe of Judah, and Jesus is called the Lion of Judah, he is also a type of Christ. I'm not saying he's perfect, and I'm not saying he's Christ, but I'm saying this is the type of individual who stands in the stead of somebody else. And this, of course, leads to the story of Judah and Tamar and that relationship and how that comes together, because Judah refuses to become the kinsman redeemer. And that's why it's mentioned here in this chapter. He says to Tamar, wait until my son is of age and he will redeem you. But that doesn't happen. Judah doesn't make good on his word. So Tamar sets up a situation similar to what Naomi did with Ruth. Tamar sets up a situation whereas she plays the harlot, and Judah has relations with her, and the rest of the story unfolds. I won't get into all the details, but he realizes at the end of it all his sin, and he repents of the whole thing. He takes her to wife, and of that union is born Pharis. And Pharis is mentioned in Ruth chapter 4, verse 12. So the whole kinsman-redeemer idea is tied together, and that root of David, because from that lineage comes the Messiah out of David. And if you go to Matthew chapter 1, all the women in the lineage listed are Gentile women except for Mary, the last in the line. Tamar is listed there, Ruth is listed there, and Rahab is listed there. These are all Gentile women. And the idea that Boaz is this redeemer figure, and that the writer here relates that back to Pharis, is really important. Again, this whole idea that we talked about, Jesus comes out of Bethlehem. Boaz must come out of Bethlehem, and he has to be in Bethlehem. So he has to go into Bethlehem so he can come out of Bethlehem. And this completes the picture, not only contextually, but spiritually. The next verse that you've listed, the next two verses that you've quoted here, John, in the PDF, are Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, and Matthew chapter 21, verse 5. Zechariah 9, verse 9 reads, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly, and riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the foal of an ass." Then Matthew chapter 21, verse 5 reads, "Tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, and a colt, the foal of an ass."
Obviously, Matthew chapter 21 is a fulfillment of prophecy mentioned in Zechariah chapter 9. And what's so important about that is the word choices, the foal of an ass. In many modern Bibles, what they do is they pervert it and change it from an ass to something like a donkey, and they kill the discernment. In fact, almost all of them change it to a donkey. And the problem is that the Holy Spirit defines spiritually what is an ass, and that is defined elsewhere in Scripture. So I'm going to go and look at my Bible here, and in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 3, it says, "The ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib, but Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider." When I read that for the first time, the Holy Spirit was teaching me to associate an ass with Israel. In other words, your typical backslidden Christian church that just struggles to believe Jesus Christ, because that's a major theme in the Bible. And so Jesus comes riding upon an ass because the ass symbolizes the Christian church, and oftentimes they're stiff-necked and they don't listen to Jesus, but that's who he came for. He came for that which is lost, the lost children of Israel, that is, ultimately, the would-be Christian church.
Excellent discernment on that, John. Really, what you're saying is, if we remove the word ass, again, we destroy a testimony. We destroy a part of a prophecy. And the richness of the text is gone. And again, folks, the 1611 does not distort these words, these doctrines. You will find these words translated correctly, and you can trust that and correlate them with other verses and begin to plead with the Holy Spirit to give you discernment, and he will. And he'll open up all kinds of things that he hasn't opened up to John and me. And that was the nature of the early church, is everybody was led by the Holy Spirit, and everybody brought something to the church that was unique and special. God didn't reveal everything to Paul, and he didn't reveal everything to the disciples, and he sure doesn't reveal everything to you and me, John. And so I encourage people, get the 1611, commit to it, commit to the Holy Spirit, and see what he shows you, and then share it with us.
Perfect.
We then move to Zechariah chapter 11.
And it's verse 12. I forgot to put the verse in there, but Zechariah chapter 11, verse 12.
Okay. And that's correlated with Matthew chapter 26, verse 15. And so Zechariah reads, "And I said unto them, if ye think good, give me my price, and if not, forbear. So they weighed for my price 30 pieces of silver." And Matthew reads, "And said unto them, what will ye give me? And I will deliver him unto you. And they covenanted with him for 30 pieces of silver."
The chapter in Zechariah, and spiritual level is definitely talking about the Word of God or a counterfeit to it. And it's also indicating to the believer the foreshadowment of the betrayal of Jesus Christ. And you've got the price of 30 pieces of silver, which, as most people who are Christians should know, is the amount of money that was paid to Judas to betray Jesus Christ. He kissed him and gave the soldiers the indication as far as who Jesus Christ was, which one was he, so that they could take him into captivity the evening before he was crucified. And so that's why this is important, is that everybody has a price. How much are you willing to be paid in order to betray Jesus? How much money does a televangelist need in order to confess a false Bible is the Word of God, or teach people or mislead people? That's why we stay away from financial incentives, because the love of money is the root of all evil. And it says, buy the truth, sell it not. It says to freely give, because God has given us a free gift, so we should freely give to others. That's why this is another lesson about how money gets all of us in big trouble if we start commingling it with the belief in God.
What's also interesting about Matthew chapter 26, verse 15, in regard to Judas, Judas is a type of the Antichrist, and people don't get that correlation many times because he pretends to love Jesus and talks to him in a certain way and kisses him. All the while he hates Jesus. He's being nice like this to deceive Jesus. Obviously, he's not deceiving Jesus, but he thinks he is. And he's doing this to deceive the disciples who are around about. And the deception of Antichrist is Antichrist professes love for Christ and says all the right things, but in his heart hates Jesus. And that's the type of Judas that we have right here.
And I'm going to end my comments on that note, that really I'm repulsed the most, not by the people like, let's say, Anton LaVey, who claim to be a Satanist, and I think really are, and really believe in the devil, unlike what he says. He's a liar. I'm repulsed more by the people that masquerade as ministers of righteousness or as these great Christians that say, oh, I'm KJV mostly, and praise the Lord and praise you, Jesus, and are in it for their own gain. Those are the people that I really detest, because they're trying to outwardly put up this facade that they're these great believers. But I've met a lot of these people, and inwardly they're the most sinister, disgusting individuals. You wouldn't even believe how some of these beloved so-called Christian leaders or prominent Christian people are just evil to the core once you get beyond the facade. And I've fortunately or unfortunately been in a position to be able to see beyond the veneer on a number of occasions, on a number of different people that many trust as faithful Christians, and they're not. And people would absolutely be horrified and shocked if they knew behind the scenes what goes on. And I'll just end my commentary there. Give somebody, or give everybody in the audience listening, something to think about when it comes to, don't put on a show with God. He knows everything. If you're going to believe in Jesus Christ, let the Holy Spirit guard your tongue. Don't pretend to be something you're not. I'm the same person at church as I am at home. My wife could testify to that. So can my children. I don't pretend to be somebody that I'm not. I don't pretend to be more friendly than I actually am. And I think that's what a real Christian should be. Just trust the Lord. If you believe in him, believe in him. You don't have to wear medals or crosses. You don't have to dress up in your best suit all the time. You don't have to pretend to be something that you're not. And that's what we're getting to here, is that Judas, Jesus said, was a devil, and totally paid lip service to him and sold him out for his own gain. And then God put such a guilt complex on him that he couldn't live with it. And we know what happened to Judas. He could not live with himself for what he did in betraying Jesus Christ. And ultimately, all the people that are paying lip service to Jesus Christ right now, they're going to get what they deserve in the end. So in the meantime, we should all just be sincere and humble and walk in the Spirit, meaning believe the testimony of Jesus Christ, so that our flesh is not held against us at the day of judgment.
Well said, John. And you just described what Jesus called the broad road. These are the folks yelling at the top of their lungs, hallelujah, praise the Lord, and all of this kind of stuff, and boasting about the wonderful things they've done. And Jesus turns and says, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you. But yet, when you go to the average broad road church, what they're going to teach you that means, oh, the broad road, that's the world. No, it's not. That's not what Jesus said. He's talking about the apostate church when he refers to the broad road. And then he contrasts that with the narrow road. And that's the only thing that makes sense. So the broad road, that's where all the phonies are going. The world is not the broad road. Lucifer doesn't care about the world. What does he care about the world? It's already doing what he wants. It's on its way to hell in a handbasket. The broad road is where the phonies are that are putting on the show. And Jesus says, I'm not fooled by it. The road is narrow and there's few on that road. It's straight. And he uses the word straight, S-T-R-A-I-T, as in the Straits of Gibraltar. There's not many people there. It's lonely there. And John, when people send me emails and they express the loneliness once they get past the KJV and the institutional church, I have to encourage them that Jesus said that's how it is. There's not going to be a lot of people there. There were not a lot of people at the foot of the cross when Jesus was crucified. Where were those 5,000 people that he entertained at the Sea of Galilee and fed? Where were they? Nowhere to be seen. Who was at the tomb? Who went there? Few indeed were true followers. And so, John, I think we should probably close off at this point. We're not through the PDF. We're only on page 7, and there's nothing stopping us from picking up next time around. Would you like to give us a parting comment, or shall I just close things off?
I will just say that I look forward to continuing this for the next week or two. And in the meantime, Reg, we can share our research notes on the Septuagint in the interim. I think it's going to take us 2 or 3 weeks to prepare for that one. I've got to go back and check my research notes. But I'd really like to finish this Messiah and counterfeit Messiah prophecy discussion with you, because I think it's been very powerful so far, and I think it's going to help a lot of people understand how if you tamper with any little word, it can destroy discernment completely.
And I think it ties into all the lessons we've done on the corruptions that have crept into the modern Bibles. It ties into what we've taught the 1611 teaches, say, in the Song of Solomon or in Genesis chapter 3, verse 5. Everything is connected, so it's a great opportunity for us to reference back to some of these things we've taught and establish a little bit more context and relevance so that people realize that these changes, these so-called minor changes, are extremely important. They're long-reaching. And so I'll leave it at that, John, and I sure look forward to talking to you during the week. We'll talk about the Septuagint and move that along, as you said. And in the meantime, God bless you, John. Thanks for taking the time out of your lunch hour. We look forward to it. I know everybody appreciates it. So I'll leave it at that. God bless, and I'll talk to you next week.
Hey, same here, Reg. Take care, God.
Bye-bye. Rejoice.